Hey, how's it going? It is Tuesday, July 28th. This is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. Today we'll get some coronavirus updates, and protests have been going on in Israel for weeks now. And looking into the week's scriptures, let's look at the book of Luke. So, how are you guys doing today? I hope you guys are having a wonderful Tuesday already. Well, if it's the morning and it's just started for you, and those of you who listen to it in the afternoon, I hope you guys had a wonderful day already. I'm just grateful and thankful you're joining us here on the Morning Star Drive. Keep liking and commenting, and I want to hear from you guys and see how you're doing. Remember, last Sunday edition, we met Haku Miri from Mongolia. Insightful, inspiring interview. I had a lot of fun doing it. Make sure to take a look at the Sunday edition as well. And this week's, just everyone needs to know, Sermons in the Sky is unlisted now. So please save that link. And if you want to get, actually after this week, I'm probably going to have to be taken off the Sermons in the Sky link from my descriptions. So please save it. I'm going to keep adding more lectures to it. And if you don't have it, just go. I'm going to leave me a personal message or email me. Email me and I'll leave my contact on the bottom. So you guys can email me if you don't have the link for the unlisted Sermons in the Sky. I'm going to keep it in the descriptions for now until a little bit later. I'm going to take them all off. All right, cool. So let's get into today's featured artist of the day. Oh, I got some good news too. You know, today's like the 96th episode, huh? Which means that next Monday is going to be the 100th episode. So I'm super excited about this. I got some good surprises for you guys, for all of you on Monday. You're going to notice something different about this podcast. Some cool stuff going to go on. So if you, stay tuned. Monday is the 100th episode. So I'm really, really happy about this, that we made it to 100 episodes already. Isn't that crazy? So after this, I guess my next goal would have to be 500 or 700. Maybe you know what? I'll do like the rapture. Since 100 is first, we'll go 300 next, right? 300 will be my next big goal. Okay, so let's get into the featured artist of the day. Today's featured artist is from Japan. It is Kuma Chang, and we're going to hear that that song that a lot of people like is called Stop the Elevator. The second song is a new song that was just posted on Paper Music Associates for Man and Groom, and that song is called Now, or in Korean is Chigum. Right, but the song is called Now. So that's a new song that just came up. So I was really surprised that they're getting some new music put up there on the Paper Music Associates, the Korean label. And the third song is Studio 316. We're going to hear a song called Until the End featuring Mariah Henry. So everyone, let us support all these members that are just making amazing and great work all over the world. Today we're listening to Japan, Korea, and America. Cool. So everyone sit back, relax, and let's support our amazing artists from around the world.
We'll be right back. 흐릿했던 날씨가 이제 꽤 맑은 듯해 숨이 자꾸 날 움켜쥐고 뭐라도 해야 될 것 같은 이 느낌 속은 맨인공 하늘 위로 가족에게 다시 전화 걸어 지난 날 알았다고 빛이 아냐 이제는 비밀 우린 계속 어쩌려고 친구에게 자신을 말하지 럭키 컨택 영원하지 옛날 사진처럼 우린 여전 직진 난 아직 잊지 못해 순수한 야만 꾸리지 이걸 뜯어내긴 내 신념이 단단해 그 삽 가지곤 안 돼 더 큰 걸 들고 덤벼 사실 중요하지 않아 이젠 기꺼 삶이 없는 사람들의 텅 빈 시선 이상주의자인 내 현실은 고통 이어도 내 신념을 갉아먹진 않죠 나도 꽤 많은 실수를 하고 비관 저기 대범했던 자신에게 미안 Sorry for my homie, really love me 하나 둘씩 알아가는 이게 재밌어요 알을 깨는 것이 그때마다 두려워도 내 생각만큼 큰 일이 아니었고 그걸로 셀링 높은 파도 보내 기계도 짜릿한 걸 난 정말로 매 밤마다 했던 내 기도가 눈 앞에 난 목적 있고 있게 하고 싶어 하늘 안에 악마들 달려들어도 하나님께 매달리네 죽을 때가 돼도 무게 매달이 달려있게 이길래 영원히 So, 나 잠을 잘래 거울 나도 난 좋게 저기 서별을 달래 꿈에 다가기도 부족해 So, 나 잠을 잘래 거울 나도 난 좋게 저기 서별을 꼭 달래 꿈에 다가기도 부족해 꿈에 다가기도 부족해 꿈에 다가기도 부족해 꿈에 다가기도 부족해 꿈에 다가기도 부족
Wait, not making his heart be upset. The fortress of my heart should open for one. Yes, only for him should my heart be undone. But then I was weak and my enemies won when I disregarded his heart. But I will surely not give up until it is complete. Regardless of how long it takes, I'll not accept defeat. Whether it takes my full many days or forever I'll work in a myriad of ways the end which exists and I know I will raise my level and it will be judged I just want to make myself really hate you for only then am I quite safe in weakness my enemies still can break through and wreak havoc more on my faith My work is so tiny when seen next to his That failure embarrasses me and it is So frustrating failing to live as he says My spiritual nature is weak I will surely not give up until it's complete Regardless of how long it takes I'll not accept defeat Thank you. time I will do it, I promised I would. No longer will partially do. I'll make myself how I've been taught that I should. 300% with the truth. The end, it is strong, it is perfect, complete. And when I am flawless and sin obsolete, then I will be worthy and then we can meet forever and I will not fall. I will surely not give up until it is complete. Regardless of how long it takes, I'll not accept defeat. For whether it takes my life or merely days, or forever I'll work a myriad of ways. To the end which exists, you know I will raise my level.
That was Until the End, and it's from Studio 316, and that was featuring Mariah Henry. That second song we heard was from Man and Groom, Paper Music Associates. That's a new single. It's really kind of short song, but it's a new one. It's called the Chigum or Now. And the first one is from our ever-famous Kuma Chang in Japan, Stop the Elevator, one of my favorite songs on his SoundCloud account. So let's move on into the coronavirus updates for today. Hope you guys are looking forward to. Some great news is, all across the board, every single country we talk about today, their mortality rate went down. And most importantly, the world mortality rate went down. In the world, 16.5 million cases, 653,000 deaths at 3.96%. Great news. The U.S. at 4.4 million, which is about a fourth. It's about a fourth of all cases. 150,000 deaths at 3.42%, still going down. Brazil, 2.4 million cases, 87,000 deaths at 3.6 million. India is at 1.4 million, 33,000 cases, 2.26%. So when we kind of look at this, just as before, it's 16.5 million cases in the world, and we have about 8.2 million cases, which means roughly half of them are still coming from those top three countries, U.S., Brazil, and India. And if you look at the deaths, so the deaths are probably not going to reach... It's 150,000 plus 111,000, which makes it 260,000 deaths. So at least the deaths are not half of them, just the cases, which probably means that there's probably better testing in those countries too. Let's look at South Africa. South Africa is 444,000 cases, 6,700 deaths, 1.52%. Mexico, 390,000 cases, 43,000 deaths at 11.19%. Good news, it went down drastically, I think like by 0.07%. Colombia, 249,000 cases, 8,500 deaths at 3.42%. And the Philippines, 82,000 cases, 1,900 deaths, 2.37%. Good news about Sweden. Sweden was one of the countries we've been kind of looking at for a while because they were a country that did not go into full lockdown. And also Belgium, which had the highest mortality rate, which they still do, I believe. And they're at 14.87%, dipping under 15%, which is great news. Other good news coming from when you look at the daily infections. The U.S., their growth rate went down to 1% again, so they're at 56,000 cases for the day. Brazil's at India's next with 50,000 cases, which is a new record for them at 4% growth. Brazil's at 23%, and lastly, Mexico's at 6,700 cases at 2% growth rate, and lastly is Colombia. Colombia's 8,100 cases with 3% growth rate. All right, so we're going to get into some more protesting, but not in America, not in Brazil, and not in Russia like we talked about yesterday. This one is actually coming from Israel, which is very, very interesting. Israel has been protesting for weeks already. Like, even in the past, there was, like, these black flag activists, anti-democratic, you know, they're going against the anti-democratic rule in the past. But now it's a lot different because a lot more people are involved in this protest because it's because of the prime minister. It's Benjamin Netanyahu, right? And he's a PM at the time, and he's under fire because it's kind of his there's a couple reasons. Number one is his response to the coronavirus. Basically, he even admits to this, that he opened the economy too quickly, and there's just, like, far too many people gathering. Now, the second wave's coming in, and it's hitting much, much harder than the first one. I believe they have, if I were to take a look at how many cases they have right now, I believe last week they had about 60,000 cases, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be much higher than that right now. I'll double-check onto this one here for Israel's, the amount of cases they have. I'm not sure about the amount of deaths either. Let's take a quick look over here. Take a quick look. Let's see. If they're at 60,000, there must be. Let's take a look at Israel. Israel looks like they have. No, still not too bad. They're at 63,581 cases with only 474 deaths, which is a great, you know, which is good because that's only 0.75%, which is, I think, is probably the best news about it, right? The best news about that is. Yeah, it's only 474. They haven't even hit 1,000 deaths yet, and they have 63,000 cases, which is pretty good. But yeah, so but there's a lot of unrest because, you know, well, let's get a little bit more into this. The coronavirus handling, the government, how the government's handling it is they're kind of – that first wave, they handled really, really well. They were one of the first countries to go into lockdown. And the bigger problem is – after going into lockdown and coming back out of lockdown, there was a failure to expand the system of testing and tracing. So now they are far, like they are so ill-equipped right now for the second wave. And I'll just give you some stats on what's going on there. Like when it comes to testing, you know, before in the past, they're trying to get that to about 48 hours, which is still terrible because that means there's still 2 days where this person is passing this passing the coronavirus around, infecting other people. But right now they say the average time it takes to get a test result is 6 to 8 days. So basically this person is roaming around. They don't even know if they had the coronavirus or not. And all these people are getting tested, but it's taking over a week, right? It's taking up to over a week for them to get their results. So that's a really bad thing because they don't know how long, you know, how many people they've contacted in the meantime. Health ministry, they went against expert advice. And, you know, they really need to test people whether someone's infected or not, but they're not doing that. And they're not stopping the chain of infection. They got to cut it off before, you know, that looks like the head of the Hydra. You cut off one head, three more heads come out, right? So they're under a lot of pressure right now. And I believe they just announced last week of a new, like, a financial package to support people. And it's like $5.7 billion package that they just opened. However, It's the thing that's getting everyone really upset with the prime minister is the way he's handling the policies with the economy. So he'll like open restaurants and then a few days later he'll close it. Then he'll open it again. Then he says we're going to stop this. And then later he reverses everything he's saying. So this is something that's kind of putting distrust in the people with the government because they keep announcing something and then like several days later they go back on it and they say, no, we're going to open the restaurants again. So this is causing a lot of distrust between the people and the government, and this is crazy. On top of this, the prime minister, like Netanyahu, he's going through like corruption scandals right now, three of them. He's going through three corruption scandals at the moment. And I believe the three corruption scandals is like fraud, accepting bribes in a series of scandals, and a breach of trust. And he's the first prime minister in Israel ever to be on trial while in office. So that's pretty crazy too. So because of all these things happening, they just had a poll. And the trust of the public is now 29% towards the prime minister. So that's not very good news. And these protests are happening outside the prime minister's house. They're voicing their concerns of the coronavirus, the corruption, the economy. What are you going to do with these businesses that all shut down? Their unemployment rate went up to 20%. So that's pretty crazy. 20% unemployment rate. And they're still waiting for packages. And you know what? I didn't actually even check how much it was. But they said that the amount of money they got was probably not – it was probably not even the amount that the prime minister would use in a single day. There's a lot of scuffles going between police and protesters, water cannons and batons being used. And it's been weeks since these protests. And a lot of people are asking for medical aid and financial aid, but it's not coming. Public, you know, this public anger is just, you know, like we talked about the corruption. Like, it's just fueling the public anger right now. The protest is not just against the prime minister. Like, they are interviewing a couple people. They said they're protesting against the whole system and the regime. Calling, and, you know, basically they're calling the protesters anarchists. And the protesters are very upset about this. But, you know, of course, some violence is coming out of this. Like I said, there's already 63,000 cases, but aid is coming way too late. And everyone's just kind of sitting at home, not making money. And they feel like these government officials are just stealing millions of the dollars that they put in for taxes while everyone sits home not making any money. So they're really calling for justice at the moment. One interesting thing is I was watching some of the protests, and in the news they said that Israel is one of the only countries that has like social distancing protesting, which is great. Because at least they're doing it smartly, right? They all are like, I think 1.5 meters away from each other, plus they're wearing masks and they're protesting. So that's a good sign, at least that they're doing social distancing while their tens of thousands are in the streets protesting. At the moment, the daily infection rate is up to about 2,000 people a day. So it's pretty serious. And against the Prime Minister Netanyahu, I think there's like 5 demonstrations last week, and there's probably more coming. And there's actually 2 sides of protesters, if this sounds kind of interesting. There's those against the prime minister and those that are for the prime minister. So that's why there's these 2 separate sides that are going at it right now. And let's see. So it's interesting. Yeah, it's very, very interesting because it's this kind of... We're looking at the judgment that's happening that we've seen for the last 5 months. And the thing that's very, very interesting is it's like... It's almost like everything's coming out at the same time. Like every country in the world, all the corruption, all the people that are upset, all the things that people thought or the government thought that would never come out is all coming out right now. And it's very, very interesting to see like even Russia, like of all countries, you would never have thought that people would go against Vladimir Putin, the president over there. But it's all coming out right now. People are very, very upset by this. So even when I look at this, it's pretty interesting how God is kind of really judging all the leaders, right? Like Xi Jinping in China. You also see things are happening with the government in the U.S. It's happening with like Israel we just saw, also in Brazil. It's a lot of things kind of being revealed right now at the time. And I hope that we'll be able to pray a lot more in detail now that we know what's going on. So that brings us into a time of praise, right? We want to praise and give glory to the Holy Trinity. So the 3 songs for today. The first one is the new songs of the Lord. The second one is For Whom Did I Come? And I chose that one because that was the one that was conducted on Sunday, and we got a deeper meaning of what that actually meant. It's that deep heart that God is ringing the bell for humankind and not for himself. So it's really, really deep song. And the last one is To Love the Lord. So let's all praise together at this time.
Years, it's the truth. ministry of the Lord. The Spirit holds the Lord tightly in both of our arms. This is the 1,000-year history. Love is ours evermore. From the Lord's great new songs, the word overflows with the fulfilled heaven's will. Only through love all was fulfilled. Now my spirit holds the wedding feast up in heaven. Through the Lord all was after 6,000 years, it's the true history of the Lord. The Spirit holds the Lord tightly in both of our arms. This is the 1,000-year history. Love is ours evermore. The Spirit holds the Lord tightly in both of our arms. This is the 1,000-year history. Love is ours
to this dismal world. Whom do you think I came here for? Whom do you think I struggled for? For whom does the bell toll? It was for you. You believe. You who love me and follow. To this dismal world. Whom do you think I came here for? Whom do you think I struggle for? For whom does the bell toll? It was for you. You believe. You who love me and follow. No hesitation. Take action, rather I swung the sword fearlessly. No hesitation in one single stride. From the east to the west,
from the north to the south.
Fast as lightning, heaven soared, massive and mighty, great and long.
With what trunk
I swung this great sword of the word.
Follow me and believe.
God has surely sent the Lord. It is I. Quickly, you must believe. Follow, for the time is passing.
Once the time has passed by, it will never come back.
You must believe. The Lord has come again. Time that's past is already dead now.
You must make history that will remain.
Let's create what's eternal.
Watches over all of us. I love you all. So I ask, please fulfill my will.
What does it truly mean?
That is to love the Lord. I hope you guys enjoyed those praise songs together. There was also Over Whom Did I Come, another really deep shamjonic song, and the new songs of the Lord. So that moves us into the word study of today. And of course, it is Tuesday, and we all know what that means. It means that it's time to learn a little bit more about the Bible and the scriptures that we're going through. So let's look at the book of Luke. And we've done a little bit of Luke before in the past. And there's some interesting things that we can learn a little bit more deeply about Luke himself. Now, Luke is not someone that's been in the Bible. Like, you won't find or mention him, see him mentioned in the Bible very many times. He's actually only mentioned three times in the scriptures, and it's never in the Gospels because he wasn't living at that. Well, he was living, but he wasn't one of the followers of Jesus at that time. He wasn't an apostle. And he was someone that came after the resurrection, and he was evangelized at the time of Paul. I'm not sure if it's actually from Paul, but Paul is the only one that mentions him the three times he's mentioned, Luke is mentioned all from Paul. Now, most look at Luke as the author of the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. And like we said before, most likely he was not a believer of Jesus until after the resurrection. And he was not present during the time of Jesus' ministry. He's also known as a very credible historian. Incredible attention to detail of eyewitness accounts in his writings of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Because you got to think about how incredible this is. He wasn't even following Jesus, but he has one of the most detailed, right, and eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And he wasn't even there. But he interviewed, he was very meticulous with his interview process. And also in the book of Luke, there are many parables and eyewitness accounts that are only found in Luke and not in other Gospels. So a couple examples is John the Baptist pre-birth accounts. That's only in the book of Luke. Later on, when Jesus resurrects, there was the two disciples with Jesus on the road to Emmaus. That's only in the book of Luke. Most of the, there's like more healing stories, and it has one of the most detailed birth of Jesus accounts. And it's one of the most descriptive of his accounts of Jesus' death. So this is, you know, it's something that's very, it's quite amazing because he wasn't even following Jesus at that time, but he was able to get that much information. He knew a lot of different things that other people couldn't get because he was the one meticulously interviewing other people who were eyewitness, who had eyewitness accounts. I think we heard this last time too, but everyone has to recognize Luke was actually a Gentile. Highly educated, and you can tell by the vocabulary that he uses. He used a lot of Greek expressions, not Hebrew expressions. And Paul addressed him as a Gentile in the book of Colossians. And one thing that's really interesting about Luke is he is the only Gentile to write a book in the Bible. The only one. There's no other Gentile that wrote except for Luke, which is quite amazing. Especially when you read his books, you'll notice that he is kind of writing to a Gentile audience. And he references like common Hebrew practices and traditions like circumcision and such that are known facts to the Jews. But you can tell that he's kind of writing towards a non-Hebrew, right? A non-Jewish audience. Many people know he is a physician, and Paul referred to him as a physician too. And one thing that you got to take a look at is he was a physician living a comfortable life. I believe he lived – where did he live? I remember I was reading about it. But he sacrificed a comfortable life as a physician to follow Paul around. He was one of the people that was always traveling around with Paul. Super humble. And one of the ways you can tell how humble he is, he never, ever addressed himself in his books. You'll never hear his name. Yeah. And he doesn't even address himself as one of Paul's companions. He doesn't address his profession. He's not talking about how much he sacrificed to be in that position. The only thing he ever mentions is his brother Titus. And that's it. So a lot of scholars will look at him as like a very, very humble. You know, how many times have you ever heard a sermon on Luke? It's very rare, right? We also know that he met some of the apostles. Particularly Mark. Mark was someone who traveled with Paul too. So if Mark traveled with Paul, that means, and Luke traveled with Paul, which basically means they knew each other. And most likely he knew Matthew because Matthew was close to Mark, right? So he probably met both Mark and Matthew, and they were both most likely interviewed by Luke. Like Luke, in his investigator writings, he probably interviewed both of them, Matthew and Mark. And one thing very, very interesting about Luke, he was the only one that remained with Paul until Paul died. He never left Paul's side when persecution grew at a very high level. Christians were being killed. At that time, many Christians were fleeing Rome. Like not because they left their faith, but you know, they continued to preach the gospel in other places because it was just too hot in Jerusalem. In Rome, right? So many Christians fled from Rome, but he was the one that stayed with Paul. And he wrote a third of the New Testament, and Luke was considered one of the most powerful writing forces in the New Testament. But as crazy as it sounds, no one really knew who he was. Yeah, he was just so humble. He never wrote anything about himself. So that's just really interesting thing to see, that this is what the life that he was living. Luke was a historian. He wrote one of the Gospels. He was an evangelist. He was a physician, a pastor, a missionary, companion of Paul. He was a brother, a theologian. And basically his main soul thing was nothing about himself. It was all about writing exact truth. And this is why he was the one investigating, interviewing people and such. Amazing person. It's really sad though that he was someone that was not is not mentioned very much in the Bible, but he's such a big part of the New Testament, especially the Bible, right? Of writing the Bible. So when I look at what Luke did, it's just amazing, amazing, right? So I hope that you guys will really be able to appreciate the books of Paul a lot more. The books of Luke a lot more. And just Luke himself. That'll be great. All right. So let's get into the song of choice for today. And the song of choice today is coming from Ina in Minnesota, one of our faithful listeners here. And she has a great request for a song. It's from a Christian rock band, and the band is called Royal Taylor. And the song came out in 2013. It's called Remain. And, it's a Christian rock band, but secular-wise, in the Billboard 200, they reached all the way to 95, which is really impressive for a Christian band. So this is Royal Taylor, and this is a song from Ina in Minnesota, and it's called Remain. So let's listen.
I know you're feeling weighted down. It's all on your shoulders. I know the dreams in your head. Don't look any closer. But I'm gonna make you stronger. Hold on just a little bit longer. Cause I'll be there. When you feel like you're going under, I'm gonna be there for you, yeah, yeah, yeah.
locked and I'll keep it close. And when you're walking through fire, I'll take you to streets of gold. Yeah, I'm gonna make you stronger. Hold on just a little bit longer, 'cause I'll be there when you feel.
Is Royal Taylor with Remain. I hope you guys really enjoyed that song. That's a request all the way from America in Minnesota from Ina. Thank you for that wonderful request. Yes, we are counting down to the last 4 days in July. And yes, yesterday I kind of made some mistakes saying it was the last week of June, but it is the last week of July, and we're going to hit August by this Saturday. How crazy that sounds, right? We're already going to go into August. 4 days left. I hope you guys will enjoy the end times of July, right? It is the end. And I hope you guys, you know, more than the end, it is going to be the end of all the things that we didn't get done, but we have this, for us, especially in Malaysia, we have one more month of this movement control order or this quarantine lockdown we have over here. Of course, there was the Prime Minister that came on TV last week in Malaysia saying that if the numbers, the cases reach up to triple digits, we're going to go back into a lockdown, which is pretty crazy. Well, you know, I don't mind it though, because I've kind of enjoyed the lockdown a bit. But 4 days left, guys. 4 days left in July. It's crazy. That means we've passed the halfway mark, because June and July is a halfway mark. We're going to August, full out into the second half of the year, which means August, September, October, November, December, 5 months. Man, 5 months till the end of 2020. As crazy as that sounds. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into we're going to talk a little bit about the Bible. We're going to start from Genesis, all the way back in the past of the things that happened. So I hope that you guys will really, really be able to enjoy some of these the interesting information we can get from the Bible, okay? So let's start with creation. The So I'm not going to read the Bible. Like,
in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
Like, I'm not going to do that, right? What we want to know is what is actually happening from the beginning of time. And one thing that we do know, that there is a key point from Genesis chapter 1. The key point, why did God write in the scriptures about the 7 days of creation? Yes, in the beginning, right, there was nothing. It was emptiness. But then on day one, there was light. And what happens is, especially when a lot of us begin to teach the Bible and we get into the 7 days of creation, trying to prove that it's not literally 7 days. And one thing we never want to forget is, why did God even write about the 7 days of creation? And first and foremost, beyond anything else, it wasn't to fool people. It wasn't to tell people like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you believe it's a full 7 days. The whole reason and the purpose for Genesis chapter 1 is to show that it is God that has created all things. More than any other detail, more than any other verse in chapter 1, it is that God is the one that created all things. That He is the creator. He is the one that made our planet, the universe, all the stars. And there will be nothing that is more important than that one fact, that it is God who has done all these things. It would be the same as us looking at our parents. We don't know a lot about our parents. We don't know all the details of who our mom and our dad is, and it may take 30, 40, even 50 years to really get to understand your parents. But yet, the one thing we know, and the one thing that is clear in our hearts and our minds, is that they created us, that we came from our parents. And in love, we were chosen to be born into this world. And God too, just like parents, God and the Holy Spirit, they came together and they created the universe, starting from light. And then from light, He made the sky. Yay, it is me. And on the third day, God made land. Then the fourth day, there was the sun, the moon, or the stars. And then the fifth day is where the waters teemed with living creatures and birds flew in the air. And finally, on the sixth day, the most important one, when everything was ready, first He created land, producing living creatures, animals. And finally, human beings were created in God's image and likeness. And of course, when we understand, just as God is creating, He puts the most important thing last, because everything must be prepared first. And if we realize, in the same way, human beings aren't any different. Before we have kids, of course we need to be married, and be, you know, and how do married couples prepare for children? First, they need a house. The house is like the most expensive thing. It takes the longest time. And in the same way, the universe was created. And when they make this house, they get a room that's for their child, which is like the galaxy or the Milky Way. And in this room, they paint, they do all these decorations. But the most important part of that bedroom is going to be that crib or that bed. And that would be the earth. And on this earth, the very center, in the Garden of Eden, God placed Adam and Eve. And that would be in this comfortable spot, which would be where the pillow and the blankets are. And just as God created all these things, with the animals, trees, rocks, and everything was fully prepared before man came into the picture. We are the same, and because we love our children, and when we have children, we prepare everything first. All the diapers, even clothes, painting the room, little toys, all these things are prepared first. And then when the child is born, we put that child into that prepared room. Just as God prepared the universe, the galaxy, all the stars and planets and moons, and eventually the earth, and on that earth, with all the greenery, animals, food, fruits, and plants, he laid human beings into this world. We must never forget that the most important thing that mattered to God, the biggest thing that he's telling us, is that we have a creator. There is someone out there that has loved us even before we were born. And it's a hard concept to think about, that man, before I even existed, God loved me. But we're just the same. We're just the same. Even before our child is born, we already love the child. Even before we're pregnant, when we just decide that we should have a baby, already the thoughts in our hearts and our minds, whether it's a son or a daughter, playing catch, holding the baby, feeding the baby, taking care of them, and just loving them with all of our hearts. We too are the same. We love our children even before they're born, and we only think of these great things that these children are going to do and how happy we're going to be because of them. In the same way too, God prepared each and every human being, and he's loved everyone even before we were born. And it's very possible, because we can do it too. Just got to remember that this first story is kind of like the beginning of a love story between us and God. And if we can recognize this more than the verse and the details in the verses, we have to see God is saying, hey, I created you because I loved you. And I've already promised to love you with everything that I have, even before you were created. And once we get this in our head first, and once we understand this point, a lot of the details, even if we don't understand it, it's not going to matter. Because even with my father and my mother, yeah, there's still a lot of things I don't understand about them. There's still a lot of things that I'm, you know, still like, I misunderstand too. But man, it means nothing. Those details are nothing. Because I know how much they've taken care, how much they love me more than anything else. And I hope that us too, not just looking at God, but looking at our physical creators like our parents, we have to really love them back also. I hope that, you know, we've only gone over one chapter, but I hope this really kind of opens our heart to seeing the Bible. And understanding it from the big picture first. Knowing God starts with understanding first that he's the one that has created all these things around us, and it was God who is our creator. Okay, so I hope that this helps you with our first Bible program, going over the beginning with the book of Genesis with all these wonderful stories. That all of you guys here too will be able to enjoy it more and more each and every day. All right. So what does that mean? It means, of course, that it's time to end today's program. Yes, it is Tuesday, the 28th of July, and I hope you guys had a wonderful show here. I enjoyed the show. I did too. This is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're hitting off on the 96th. The 96th episode, closing on 100. So if you got any requests or any questions you have, just leave them in the comments. All right, bye-bye. To make this life a wonderful adventure. You want to make it happen? Don't ever back down from the challenge ahead of you.